Hi, my name's Steve Kinney. I'm the head of front-end engineering at Temporal, and this is a course on React performance.
In this course, we'll learn how to make sure that you're writing your code in the most performant manner possible. You'll learn how to structure your component hierarchy to make sure that your application performs as performantly as possible. You'll learn how to memoize components using built-in React tools. You'll also learn how to load code just as it's needed, and we'll also learn a little bit about the concurrent features in React 18. I hope you enjoy the course.
And we'll open up the tools, and we'll verify what my very fancy screen recording already told us, that things re-render quite a bit in here. Right? Every keystroke changes everything, right? And let's take a look. Let's see if we can acquiesce some of the issues here. So we'll hit it. And we can see that application is rendering, which renders the header. The nice place you can hover over renders our items list, both of them over here. Those are then triggering, a bunch of items to re-render as well. They're getting new props. That's cool. That seems interesting. Those props are just functions that they're going to call eventually. We can see each one, so on and so forth. And there they are. They exist. Things are cool. So you can kind of see the color kind of signifies how much you need to deal with it. But let's go take a look at the app and see what we immediately see just by staring at it. We know that it's application at the very top root of everything that is causing the issue. But the first thing we saw was that typing in the input field was somewhat problematic. And so if we look, this is where we talked about in the very beginning when we saw that picture of the tree, right? Here, we have whatever that new item's name is going to be, like that draft state, whatever they've currently typed in the input field, that lives in application, right? And we saw that application was the one triggering everything in this initial case. And some things will live in application, right? Because again, in React, generally speaking, whatever the shared state has to live at the highest, most node that all of the components are using it, have in common, right? So at some point that is application for things like everyone's favorite current user, right? And places along those lines. So that triggers stuff. And sometimes the name of the game is before we start smothering stuff in a react.memo or use memo or should component update or anything like that is could we get that tree smaller, right? And my hypothesis is that we can, because I am passing in that draft state to this new item component. I am passing in, the set new item name, and I am passing in the add item. So, in this case, the refactor is pretty easy. We go into this new item, and we say what if you, since you are the only component in my app that cares about what's in that input field, we care when they hit submit. I'm here for it. When they hit submit, please tell me about what it is. But in the meantime, why don't you keep that information to yourself, right? And this one gets filed under, I think I told you there was the things you should probably maybe always do, things you should definitely always do, run in production mode, things you should probably maybe always do, which is something like this, which is just pushing it down the tree. You're not memoizing anything, you're not doing anything. You're just taking the thing that was happening and having its blast radius. It's like taking your worst friend and not letting them hang out with the ones that you like. You still want to hang out with them, but not all the time. That's how Mark feels about me. And so we kind of have that state in there, and that will go ahead and keep track of all of that. Now I can get rid of it out of application. And so now we've gotten rid of that one, and let's make sure my code compiles while Alex asks me a question.
Yeah, what about the most obvious thing, wrapping the get original items into an anonymous function here?
That'll do it too. That one wasn't particularly expensive. We can do it. Both work. Because it's tricky because this thing isn't actually that slow. It just is re-rendering all over the place. So now we can say, and now if you look at the green lines, or yellow if I really slam on the keyboard, what's the only thing re-rendering? Because now it's its own subtree, and it's not bothering anyone else. It's not talking to application. Now, if I hit add, right? Okay, But like, that's worth it. That's where the items live. If it was an application, like, that is the common denominator of the packed and the unpacked lists. But that input field wasn't. That is one of the very first like easy optimizations that like isn't harming anyone, right? Like, push that state down to the lowest common denominator that needs it. And like, it's like, lift it up as high as you need to, but as low as you can get away with, right? Instantly just makes the tree shorter without calling any crazy memoize functions or any kind of caching or anything like that. Just trying to limit its blast radius and what renders it causes immediately kind of like solves that issue. I would like to present my case, if I may. I am going to just, I didn't mean to hover. I'm gonna let this sit on the screen for like just bordering on what becomes an almost uncomfortable amount of time that doesn't feel like putting a cut in, but just long enough for dramatic pause. Does anyone see what the problem is? That Dustin's like, he's about to hit the button. All right. On the fly, at the very last minute, we're taking these two things and we're putting them in a brand new object. That brand new object is not the same object as it was last time. Items might be the same. Dispatch might be the same, right? But this object is brand new, which invalidates all of those checks in React.memo. And like, some things just care about dispatch, right? Like before, items by themselves, they're like, yo, if I'm getting the same item I got last time, even if the list is old new, I'm good. I'm cool. Like, dispatch is the same, getting the same item, right? But here, technically, it is pulling dispatch off of a brand new object, right? Like, the ES6 syntax hides it from us, but the rules are being followed once again, right? All of the initial rules that we set up in the very beginning are true, and we just opted out of everything, while also still having those React memo checks, and they're doing nothing now, right? They're useless. They might as well take them out. So one context caused our problem. Do you know how we solve it? I heard you like contexts, so I put context in your context. Why didn't I make that meme and have it on a slide ready to go? One context created our problem. Two contexts is our way out, right? Because we don't mind things re-rendering when things change. That is what React is supposed to do. That is why it is re-rendering, because things change. So it has to put it on the page. Re-renderings are not bad in and of themselves. They're just bad when we don't want them. So like things like the items list changing when the items change, okay, right on. The items changed. Please show that in the UI to me. Love it. The things that just rely on dispatch, well, that seems silly. So yes, the answer to all the problems that one context solved is two contexts. One for the things that change, and one for the things that don't change. Right? Like, if that hurts your feelings, that's good. Yeah, that's a valid. Yeah.
So, but then we will need to wrap each individual component with the context, the one that changes, to prevent the same thing, or no?
Well, so we already have this like abstraction here that is taking one context and wrapping children, which is the whole application. And are you all familiar with the turducken? Right, we can just keep, it's like it's a turkey, a duck, and a chicken all in one dish. And like, what we can do is basically take the same approach and try some dark move like this. I don't even know what the name stuff anymore. Action context. Cool. Now for the items, like that's just going to be passing through. And then what we do . This is now a static value that is never going to change. Right? And so now, the important tasting note that I want to call out is the order is important. Right? because all parents trigger re-renders on their children, right? So we're going to put the one that doesn't change outside of the one that does change. That's the same way that we pushed down the changes earlier. We're doing that here now effectively, which is the one that doesn't change is going to be inside of the one that does change. You're like, could you memoize them? Yes, I can. I don't want to, right? Not doing stuff is faster than doing stuff. So we've got those in place. And now I have two. So now instead of use context with the, if you need the items, you use the items context. And if you need the actions, you use the actions context, right? And let's try it out. We'll go into the individual item. Now we should be able to just swap this one out at least. And pull that in. What you mad about? I mean, there's plenty to be mad about. Header's mad, I don't really care. Oh, because they're pulling on, they're deconstructing an object before, so I can't just change it in one place. That makes sense. This is now just pulling out the regular old items. And I think this is the only other place, that, yeah. Dispatch is not a function. I left also the deconstructing here as well. Because we don't, like, the express purpose was not to make new objects, so, like, you know, let's follow through. And you look, all of my performance gains are back. But at what cost? Right? We can make it a little bit better, right? You know, like, I have a rule, which is sometimes we have to do bad things. And what do when we do bad things? We cover them up. Real quick, let's just look at the opposite and then kind of get a sense for that. You know, this will probably be the one you use most of the time because usually you are the one kicking off the thing. If for some reason you're receiving like a value that is coming from some one of those other like React like data structures, you can say like, I am listening on this thing. I'm responding to changes in my like use memo or whatever, right? But if this is one of the ones, treat this entire thing we're doing as not important because that thing is unreliable, right? Or it's slow or something along those lines. So the last one, you were kicking it off and saying, the thing I'm about to do, it's problematic, just letting you know, right? Now you're saying like, the thing I'm relying on in that dependency list, that thing over there is problematic. So like, treat me as like problematic as well. Cool, so in that case, like we do kind of walk some of this back a little bit. And so this goes back to like being the filters in this case. Awesome. Let's pull some of this out. Let's just say we couldn't do that, right? And to be clear, it's the other one is a lot easier to like think of use cases for. But I think just for full due diligence. We'll have in place. So we don't have this idea. Let's say like we can't do the thing where we keep two different things. We're gonna say like this thing could change and that is what kicked off this use memo. But we're gonna say like, yo, for putting that filters in the like input fields, go for it right now. For kicking this off, maybe chill. Maybe wait a sec. Cool, so in this case, instead of use transition, we have, nope. Right, returns the deferred version of the value that may lag behind it. Commonly used to keep the interface responsive. We have something that renders immediately based on user input and something that needs to wait for the data to fetch or something along those lines. So yeah, you can see that, like some of this becomes like useful as time goes on as well, but it's immediately useful for our purposes of worrying about performance. So now what we can do is say we've got these filters. So now make a version of this that I am less concerned about for triggering off this use memo. Right? This one can be problematic, like do it like later. It's going to alt. It is going to be the same value. Oh yeah, we don't like this one doesn't have it in is pending. But the easy way to say is like. Like, if you think about it, if the deferred filter is a value that can lag behind the real one, then when they're caught up, they're the same object. But there's a moment where for the things that can just that aren't gonna like lock up and like be problematic, that gets the new one immediately. The filter task, which takes forever, gets it when it's ready for it. You know what I mean? So then for a hot minute, they are not the same value. But when React catches up, they're once again joined as the same value. If they do not equal each other, show low A. My input field is performant. The slow thing still takes slow time, but now I can like separate like what is immediate, what is important, and what can, based on like my own heuristics, Like I kind of said in the beginning, like sometimes it's our job to step in and be like, I know the business problem I'm trying to solve. I know what I'm doing. Let me help you out here and guide you. And now we have some of the primitives to make that happen.